Good morning. Welcome to this service of the Paint Branch Unitarian Universalist Church. We're glad you're here. The host will mute everyone, and when it's your turn to speak, be sure to unmute yourself. Now David Chapman is going to bring us our opening music, Let's Get Together by Chet Powers.
Thank you, David. Welcome to worship at Paint Branch Unitarian Universalist Church. We acknowledge that the land on which our church stands is part of the ancestral grounds of the Piscataway people. I am John Barr, one of the worship associates who plans services in collaboration with church staff. I'm happy you chose to be with us today. If you are using Zoom, please run your cursor around the perimeter of your screen to find the microphone icon and be sure to remain muted throughout the service so we can hear all the speakers and performances clearly. While you do this, please also find the option for switching between gallery view and speaker view. We will be asking you to switch between these views later in the service. For now, I believe you will want to choose speaker view. You will also hopefully find the bubble icon, which in Zoom opens up the chat screen where you can read timely messages during the service from our assistant church administrator, Phil Brown. Right now, I invite you to type into chat how many people are viewing from your screen. Please type one if it's just you. Today, our stewardship team will be featured and will be highlighted by a dollar sign at the beginning of their Zoom name for reasons which will become evident later. After the service, everyone is invited to talk with members of the team about their stewardship at Paint Branch. There will also be a green team meeting after the service this Sunday at 11:45. We need everyone to come with ideas for the next green team service. Further details are available in the continuum. And a reminder, online services are recorded and are posted on our YouTube channel. You may go to YouTube and search for Paint Branch Unitarian Universalist Church and you will find them. Thank you.
On this day, when we have seen some hints of spring during the past week, we look forward to the unfolding of the green which we know is coming. We give thanks for the opportunity to gather once again, even in this online way, to share our mutual support. Come, let us worship together. We begin by singing together, "For All That Is Our Life."
It is my pleasure to invite Anita Williams to light our chalice this morning.
Good morning, everyone. I invite you to say the chalice lighting words. We light the chalice to celebrate Unitarian Universalism. This is the Church of the Open Mind, the Helping Hands, the Loving Heart, and the Radiant Spirit. Encendamos esta caliz para celebrar el Unitarismo Universalismo. Esta es la Iglesia de la Mente Abierta, de las Manos Amigas, del Amor del Corazón y del Espíritu Radiante.
Good morning, my good stewards. What a delight to be together. My pages are falling down. What a delight to be together on this joyful Stewardship Sunday. In our religious education classes, we spend a lot of time on big words, one of those words being stewardship. Last year, before our building closed, we did an entire month of classes on stewardship. Myself, the teachers, we weren't really sure if the kids would be interested in a month of stewardship, and we tried anyway. My good people, our kids were interested. Each group decided on a stewardship project and announced these projects to the congregation, including their plan to build a new bridge over the creek in the Glen. They even announced that they had already spoken with the Building and Grounds Committee, announcing that they were serious and committed to this project. I remember the collective gasp of joy from the congregation as they realized that our children are indeed stewards. May we all gasp with that kind of joy during stewardship. A year later, our kids still speak about stewardship. And while our building has been closed, they've had meaningful roles in worship, from lighting the chalice to speaking about things that they care about and we even have a youth worship associate now. Well done, good stewards. This morning, it's my great pleasure to introduce some of our children and youth stewards presenting movement to the responsibility song.
Responsible, that's me and you. I follow through what I say I'm gonna do. Dependable, that's who we are. If we give up, don't show up, we won't get too far. Everyone counts on you to be there. Everyone counts on you. It is our duty to be responsible, to follow through and be true is remarkable. If we work hard, do our part, it's all possible. Oh, 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 that's what's called responsible. Count on me, do what I say I'll do. I'll give my best every day so that I can prove. Together I believe it's up to me and you. Oh, 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 that's what's called responsible. Oh, 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 we can be responsible. That's me and you. I follow through what I say I'm gonna do. Dependable, that's who we are. If we give up, don't show up, we won't get too far. Everyone counts on you to be there. Everyone counts on you. It is our duty to be responsible, to follow through and be true. It is remarkable. If we work hard, do our part, it's all possible. Oh, 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 that's what's called responsible. Count on me, do what I say I'll do. I'll give my best every day so that I can prove. Together I believe it's up to me and you. Oh, 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 that's what's called responsible. Oh, 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 you can be responsible. No, 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 no.
Well, that was fun. This Stewardship Sunday, we are pleased to present a reflection by our Stewardship Chair, Chris Evans.
Good morning. I'm Chris Evans, and I'm the chair of your Paint Branch Stewardship Committee. I've served this congregation as either the stewardship chair or co-chair during each of our 7 previous annual campaigns. Those 7 pledge drives resulted in gifts from you totaling over $2 million to support the work of this spiritual community. The generosity of the Paint Branch community is amazing, and I'm honored that I get to speak to you today on behalf of your stewardship committee as we officially begin our Connected in Community annual campaign. This year is different than any other annual campaign that I've been a part of. Not only is this our first ever entirely virtual campaign, but we have had to find new ways during a global pandemic to stay connected as a community. If that wasn't already challenging enough, we have also embarked on a period of ministry transition, and I think we all realize that there remains much more work ahead of us to nurture our beloved community. Like many of you, I've been thinking a lot about the future of Paint Branch, and if I can summon the courage to stay engaged and fully committed as we work to address so much uncertainty, call it my crisis of faith at PBUUC. So I reached out to who I often reach out to when I'm seeking wisdom about what it means to be a UU, Carol Carter Walker. The conversations that Jeannie and I had with Carol were candid and supportive and yes, even hopeful. As I continued to reflect on our conversations and my connections at Paint Branch over the weeks that followed, I've come to realize with clarity that the people here are a significant and important part of my life. And I believe that this community, even with its flaws, is my spiritual home and deserves my best efforts to become a better church for all of us. And so I'm here now to ask you to join me and decide your level of commitment to PBUUC in the coming year. Yes, we will need your volunteer time and your talents to sustain this community, but I'll be frank as well, we'll need your money. The only way we'll be able to continue our mission until it is safe for us to gather in person again is if each of us are generous during this annual campaign. Jeannie and I have always shared our financial abundance with this community, and we have decided to increase our pledge by 10% this year. So I'm asking that if you can afford to give more this year, this is the year to do it. Small and large, every pledge is important. Now I want to talk about our annual campaign for this year. We have 21 visiting stewards that are reaching out to have conversations about how we are connected in community and to ask you to complete your pledge before the end of March. Please respond when your visiting steward contacts you. Also, after the service today, you can choose to stay in the main room to meet with the stewardship committee to learn more about our annual campaign and to ask any questions you may have about giving at Paint Branch. I'd like to end my testimonial today with a reading that Carol Carter Walker recently shared with me. It has helped me shape this message to you today and is called Long Haul People from Bless the Imperfect by Rudy Nemzer, a UU minister for nearly 50 years. It goes like this. You find them in churches when you're lucky, other places too, though I mostly only know ecclesiastical varieties. Long haul people, upon whose shoulders and pocketbooks and casseroles and daylight nighttime hours, the church is built and maintained after the brass is tarnished and the cushions need restitching. They pay their pledges full and on time, even when the music's modern, support each canvas, though the sermons aren't always short, mow lawns and come to suppers, teach Sunday school when there's no one else and they'll miss the service, ask what they think of the minister or plans for the kitchen renovation or the choral anthem or Christmas pageant or color of the bathroom paint. They'll reply, individuals and fashions arrive and pass. The church, their church, will be here, steady and hail, for a long, long time. It will. For long haul people, bless a church with a very special blessing. End quote. Thank you for your generosity to our church. Thank you for being connected in community with me.
I am Sharon Worth. John's still there. I am Sharon Worth, director of the Chalice Dancers. We now invite you to join us in congregational movement. Question. I am. Okay. Thank you. I still see John. We now invite you to join us in congregational movement to a hymn many of you know, From You I Receive, To You I Give. You may do these gestures seated or standing if you are willing and able. Please follow me. From you I receive, to you I give. And it doesn't matter if you go left or right. Together we share, and from this we live. We come down so we can start again. Now, before we practice one more time, please change your screen to gallery view. I will too. Now, you can see yourselves, other congregants, and other chalice dancers in red tops. Now that we're in gallery view, we're going to practice one more time. From you, I receive. To you, I give. And now, if you look at your hand, you'll look at somebody next to you on the screen. Together we share, and from this we live. Ebeth Porter will now lead us in song. We can sing and dance together. You can follow a chalice dancer, or you are also welcome to do your own movements if you like. During the chant, you may scroll through gallery view to experience the whole congregation.
From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, and from this we live. From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, and from this we live. From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, and from this we live. From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, and from this we live. From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, and from this we live.
I invite you to return to speaker view now. Reflecting on stewardship is a challenge. I have always found giving challenging. Not the act, but deciding to whom and how much. The needs are very diverse. I mean, there's food insecurity and housing insecurity and healthcare and education and justice, and there's just so much to do. It's more than a little overwhelming. Now, the solution before the pandemic that my wife and I came to was that we would select five groups each year and we would give to them. We figured that way each group would get enough that it would be worth the administration for them to process our gift, and we wouldn't end up getting buried in junk mail. Not that that actually works, but we try. We would then go to the charity line on our budget and chop it up, and we'd write checks, and we could feel good about ourselves for the year. That worked. And then the pandemic started, and our giving changed. We have been very fortunate. We've had minimal financial impact, but I mean, the community around us, where we live in Baltimore, was really hurting. And we have a lot of connections in the restaurant community around here. I may have previously mentioned that, well, food is very central to my life, and restaurants are a big part of our lifestyle. But with COVID, we weren't going out. No one was. And so Susan and I were faced with the reality that the restaurant community that we enjoyed might not be there when the pandemic was over. But what could we do? We can't prop up even one restaurant by ourselves. That's just too much. So our answer was to just start tipping ridiculously generously. we plowed all of the money that we would have spent on wine or going out to the next trip to the tour restaurant to the few places that we could get pickup from. And not because of any service rendered, because realistically, I mean, we were kind of swinging by and grabbing food and running away. And not because of the social obligation to make sure that tip workers get paid, but because we wanted these people whom we saw, you know, every month, every couple of weeks, something like that, to continue to be able to have jobs and be there, to be part of our community. I believe it has helped. I believe that a lot of the people, other people around us, have had the same idea, because I think it's worked. The restaurants are still here. The people we know are still here. It's a bit nerve-wracking, but they're still here. So why do I talk about this today at church? Why? What reflection does this have for stewardship? Paint Branch is still the largest line in the giving bucket for my bucket, our budget. It always will be, probably. But we're not going to pull back on our other giving. Those organizations need money too. We are going to do what we did for the restaurants. We're going to look at everywhere else that maybe we aren't spending money. Places like the Vacation Travel Fund, which just isn't getting used. We're going to turn around and we're going to put that in the Paint Branch. Just like with the restaurants, we know we can't prop up the church on our own. That's ridiculous. But we can be generous and believe that our community will continue to thrive. I hope you also are able to make the same decision. For special music today, we are pleased to present Lean On Me by Bill Withers, featuring Montana Monardis.
Carry on, for it won't just call on me, brother, when you need a friend. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'd understand.
My name is Lynn Lewison, and I'm a pastoral care associate here at Paint Branch with Jim Flaherty and Kathy Bartolomeo. Now let's join our hearts and minds in a time of prayer and meditation. As we gather in worship, we carry with us life's hurts and joys. Sometimes the sharing in community of our significant life experiences and milestones can help strengthen the bonds between us and also help ease our burdens. I invite you now to share your joys and share your joys and sorrows in the chat, and I will lead a meditation after the intonation. David will now play We Are the World by Lionel Richie and Michael Jackson. Thank you. Thank you, David. Now, let us take a few minutes to acknowledge all that has been shared, as well as those joys and sorrows that remain unshared and yet are on our minds. In this quiet time, may our hearts open to hope and healing. May our minds open to hope and possibility. And now, may we hold these and one another in love and kindness so that this congregation may be a source of strength and comfort, courage and hope in the days and weeks ahead.
I want to begin this morning by reading a brief passage from a book by Jacob Needleman entitled Money and the Meaning of Life. He writes this: usually our concerns about money reduce themselves to getting or managing it, and there are countless books about that aspect of the money question. But it's almost impossible to find serious and useful thought about the relationship between the quest for money and the quest for meaning. What is the role of money in the search for consciousness, in the pursuit of that transformation of the self spoken of by the great teachers and philosophers of all epochs and cultures? It will not be an easy task to cut beneath the surface of this issue. The fact that money enters into everything means that we have to look at every aspect of our lives from the point of view of money and the force it conducts in the life of present-day civilization. Love and hatred, eating and sleeping, safety and danger, work and rest, marriage, children, fear, loneliness, friendship, knowledge and art, health, sickness, and death. The money factor is a determining element in all of these, sometimes plainly visible, sometimes blended into the whole fabric like a weaver's dye. Think of our relationship to nature, to ideas, to pleasure. Think of our sense of self-identity and self-respect. Think of where we live and with what things we surround ourselves. Think of all our impulses to help others or serve a larger cause. Think of all our psychological and biological needs. Think of where we go, how we travel, with whom we associate, or just think of what you were doing yesterday, or what you'll be doing tomorrow, or in an hour. The money factor is there, wrapped around or lodged inside everything. Jacob Needleman. This morning, I want to speak to you for a few minutes about a subject that we don't often discuss, and that is money. Maybe it seems that talking about money in church is antithetical, but that really isn't so. It is if we think money is something simply earthly and secular, but in fact, money and the handling of it are deeply related to our spiritual beings. All the major religious traditions and scriptures of the world treat the subject of getting and handling and distributing money. Let me give you some examples. In the Diamond Sutra and elsewhere, the Buddha speaks of the duty to bestow alms upon those in need. In the Tao Te Ching, that slim book of wisdom written 600 years before the birth of Jesus, Lao Tzu speaks in at least two of the 81 chapters about riches and the burden they involve. The Hebrew scriptures are filled with instructions for the bringing of sacrifices, either of money or of goods which have great value and always are to be only of the highest quality. Many of the parables told by Jesus are about money. The parable of the talents and the parable of the unjust steward are about the management of someone else's money, which has been entrusted to another. The parable of the prodigal son is about a man who wastes away his inheritance and how he should be treated after that. The parable of the Good Samaritan doesn't seem to be about money, but remember, at the end, the Samaritan pays out of his own pocket for the care of the injured man and promises to pay more if it is needed. Jesus understood the spiritual side of money. The Quran, the sacred scripture of Islam, contains instruction for the practice of som, or almsgiving, one of the five pillars of Islam. In his little book, The Prophet, the 20th century Lebanese mystic Khalil Gibran includes a chapter on giving and another one on buying and selling. Jacob Needleman understood the spiritual side of money and spoke of it in the reading which we heard a few minutes ago. His explanation clarifies the fact that money is not just an administrative necessity, not just something we have to go through every month, figuring out which bill to pay first, not just a bureaucratic exercise that is unrelated to the deeper side of life, but is deeply spiritual and filled with meaning that goes to the very core of our existence. The way we choose to spend our money reflects at the most fundamental level who we are and what we value and hope for in life. We don't scrimp so we can spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to send a child off to college so she can have a good time in a swell place for 4 years, but because what she can accomplish with a college education speaks to our deepest hopes and ideals and dreams and fears. Perhaps she can be or do something which we were never quite able to be or do. We don't make a big mortgage payment every month for a pile of bricks and mortar, but so we can have a place of comfort where our lives can go forward, where families can grow, where there can be love and work and times of joy and entertaining, which will fill our lives and the lives of those we love with meaning. For the past several Sundays and the next several Sundays, we're hearing from someone in this congregation who speaks to us about his or her own life here at PBUUC and what it has meant and how that translates into a financial commitment. I always look forward to hearing these. The messages they bring tell me that there are plenty of people in this congregation who get it, who understand that a financial commitment to the church is not about paying the rent or even meeting the payroll, but is about something much deeper and more fundamental than that. It's about our values and hopes and ideals for the future and how committed we are to them. I was thinking recently about all that goes on here at PBUUC, our beautiful building, although we're not able to use it now because of the coronavirus. Our children and our religious exploration program. We saw their talents in the responsibility video a few minutes ago. Wasn't that great? Our work for social justice, especially for racial justice, through DART and the work we are doing with the Racial Climate Assessment Report. David and his beautiful music and our chalice dancers still bringing us their talents, even though we have to meet over Zoom. All those things and more tell the story of PBUUC up to now, and now the future lies before us. What will it be like? It is going to take the commitment of time and effort and risk and yes, money, to move this congregation forward. Who will be here to carry it out? There is no one but us. Oh, it's easy and tempting to think we can just slide along and click in occasionally on Sunday morning and maybe have our children click in on Saturday afternoon family worship, and we can make some financial commitment which doesn't strain our budget and someone else will take up the slack for us. It's easy to think we're too busy and don't have enough resources or enough time to do anything really significant, including the financial commitment we make to this place. Surely others must have felt the same way sometimes. The people who founded this congregation, most of whom are now gone, must have sometimes felt tired out and frustrated, and maybe they thought, well, somebody else is just going to have to do it. But somehow they went on and founded this church, and made it what it is today. The people who so faithfully manage this congregation and bring us our music and run our RE program and keep hammering at our efforts to make a difference in social justice must sometimes feel discouraged and burned out, and maybe they think about giving up on those efforts. But they don't. They do what it takes because they see a need that's consonant with the values we share, and they know that if they didn't act, maybe nobody would. One of the great religious stories of all times is the story of Moses. Sometimes we sing about it around the time of Passover. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land, tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. Those are the instructions that came to Moses to go down into the foreign land of Egypt to confront Pharaoh, to lead the people out of bondage and into the promised land. And the story tells us that he did do it. He went down and stood before power and authority and confronted them with the voice of righteousness. And he led a nation of people to their destiny. Oh, it wasn't an easy passage. It took 40 years of wandering in the desert, but finally they got there. But if you read that story carefully, if you back up a few verses before the real action starts, you will find out that Moses didn't want to go. Oh, I'm not smart enough to be able to do that, he protested. No, Moses, you're the one. You go. But I wouldn't know what to say when I got there. No, Moses, you're the one. You go. But I have a speech impediment. Why would Pharaoh listen to me? No, Moses, you're the one. You go. Finally, having used up all his excuses, Moses just cries out, please send somebody else. No, Moses, you're the one. You go. There was no one else. And so Moses went because he was the one. And he led the people out of bondage and into their destiny because there was no one else to do it. When I was very little, I went to Sunday school every Sunday. The teachers had a thing they called a flannel board. It was just this board covered with flannel. And then they had cutouts of biblical characters with flannel on the back of them so they would stick to the board. And so we could reenact the Bible stories by moving the cutout characters around on the flannel board to interact with one another. And so we dramatized the stories of Joseph with his coat of many colors, being thrown into the pit by his cruel and jealous brothers, and then sold into slavery to be taken into the land of Egypt. We saw with our own eyes the flannel characters telling the story of David with his slingshot that brought down the giant Goliath. Stories of kings and wars and families and lovers and jealousies and hatreds. We acted out the stories of Jesus going about and healing people. So we had a picture of a house with a hole in the roof so the sick man could avoid the crowd outside and be let down through the roof on a stretcher to be healed. Stories of Jesus going about among the fishermen recruiting his disciples and saying to them, I will make you fishers of men. We did all this with the flannel board. Annie Dillard must have had the same experience. She wrote about it in her book, Holy the Firm. Remembering the flannel board and the Sunday school cutouts, she wrote this. A blur of romance clings to our notions of publicans, sinners, the poor, the people in the marketplace, our neighbors, as though, of course, God should reveal himself, if at all, to these simple people, these Sunday school watercolor figures who are so purely themselves in their tattered robes, who are single in themselves, while we now are various, complex, and full at heart. We are busy. So I see now were they. Who shall ascend unto the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? There is no one but us. There is no one to send, nor a clean hand, nor a pure heart on the face of the earth, nor in the earth, but only us, a generation comforting ourselves with the notion that we have come at an awkward time, that our innocent fathers are all dead, as if innocence had ever been, and our children busy and troubled, and we ourselves unfit, not yet ready, having each of us chosen wrongly, made a false start, failed, yielded to impulse and the tangled comfort of pleasures, and grown exhausted, unable to seek the thread, weak and involved. But there is no one but us. There never has been. There have been generations which remembered and generations which forgot. There has never been a generation of whole men and women who lived well, even for one day. That's from Annie Dillard. We know this church does many wonderful things. Those who do the work and who provide the resources perhaps at times feel discouragement and reluctance, and yet we see through to the fact that there is no one but us, that the holy work will not get done if we do not step up to it. And so we do, imperfect as we are, just as all those who came before us and all those who will come after us are imperfect. Now we have in our hands the future of PBUUC. We have in our hearts the values we share and the knowledge that we want to hold them up among ourselves and teach them to our children and spread them to this community and to the world at a time in history in which God knows our values and hopes and ideals are needed in this hurting and confused world more than at any time in the lifetime of any of us here. We know we need to make them hear us. We also know this church is one of the ways we can band together to move those values and hopes and ideals out into the world in ways which none of us could do alone. We know we are the ones who must provide the resources which make it possible to do this. Amen.
I now must bring you back to the present of stewardship from the future of stewardship. The mission of this church carries on and carries in the present. And we are so very grateful to have your financial support. Please give as generously as you are able. The offertory music today is Lennon and McCarthy's With a Little Help from My Friends.
Now may the blessing of truth be upon us, the power of love direct us and sustain us, and may the peace of this community preserve our going out and our coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. We close with Fuente de Amor, Spirit of Life.
I extinguish the chalice with this quote from Marianne Williamson. In every community, there is work to be done. In every nation, there are wounds to heal. In every heart, there is the power to do it.